Soirée. Beautiful Charlotte Hayes and Associates Fine Arts Photography and Design Gallery on Markham Street. It's a beautiful restored Victorian. Yeah, it's gorgeous. And we have two features, Mikel is featuring and Waleed Abdulhamid. And we have a bunch of open mics and, welcome to a new space and new gallery and a whole new series and a new energy, a new feeling to everything. I do video, start with an open mic. I think you'd be a great beginning, Stedmond.
I'm going to read something I never read before. I spent all summer reading about Tennessee Williams. For some reason I was obsessed with him, so I wrote a whole series of poems based on his life and his work. And this poem starts where his most famous poem play starts. Called The Glass Menagerie, and ends with the phrase, blow out your candles. And he supposedly died with a plastic medicine cap lodged between his teeth. They didn't know if he choked on it or... So, that's all you guys have to know. All right, let me get into it. Blow out your candles, Tennessee. Blow. Blow out your candles with a plastic medicine cap between your teeth. Like a purple flower on a red table and a sundial made of stone. Blow out your candles with no cough to cover the sound. Blow out your candles, Tennessee, like a ferocious-eyed woman with one of her ankles getting bitten by an irate swan or a Japanese mountain collapsing due to the fall of heavy rain. Blow out your candles with a thermometer in your mouth. Blow. Blow out your candles like a gladiator affrighted by the specter of a terrible review on opening night. Like old bedridden complainers and dazzling, implacable young shut-ins. Blow. Blow out your candles with a partly bandaged limb and a simple invention that changes everything. As tents are being blown off of their moorings, as a barman slips into his clothes for a summer hotel, and impassively wipes our dirty table to raise to a new stage the edifice of modern life. Blow out your candles, Tennessee, like a carnival barker in the French Quarter getting higher than a flightless bird and the suicide rate in Japan on the newly legal hard stuff. Like the Witch of Capri entering a sea full of Medusas. Like two women galloping across a smoky, artificial music hall atop a mechanical horse, as if they were an intricate sand painting done by a Tibetan monk. Blow, blow, blow out your candles, unencumbered by the man-made catastrophe and the attrition of the knot of Papa Time. Blow out your candles, as Mother Earth has shaken many civilizations from her back and the stage is slowly dimmed. Blow, blow out your candles, as a strange inert figure of someone you once cruised at a bar drives out of the dense fog in an abdicated roadster with one of your crushed heroines to deliver their pale judgment by blowing out your candles, Tennessee, with a silent revolver. Thank you.
Songwriter, and now you're writing poems. So welcome, Sean.
I've been writing for about actually 7 years, and I chose these because they were the earliest, and this is the first time I'm reading. So these were kind of a little bit. Almost like not the first that I would lead with, but sorry, my glasses. But I think it's best because they read like little stories, and in each one I try to write about a moment that changes everything. And in this one, it's when my daughter was 1 to 4, I was a stay-at-home dad, and the very last day I remembered very well. And I took her over to the ROM and then back to where the car was parked on Harvard Street. And it was very emotional because I realized that time my life was gone. So it's called Sweet Dreams. I said goodnight to you when you were 3 and a half, and life had changed from zoos and pools. To whom are you? From wondrous days at Riverdale to why can Bronx be so pale? And can days be so glorious to tales that are the stories that we never would have told until we grow that old? And older now I find myself in moments that I can't express on wasted keys of pages word and frightfully admit absurd. The notion that a love like ours is challenged by the breaking hour as your life opens up to you and I can swallow youth as you. It pained me just on raising arms to let you go as yet unharmed with all the possibilities for you, for me. The day I raised my arms and tears fell down on Harvard Street, I didn't realize that I would be the next one to release. Allow me to relinquish, not depend upon your love. If truth and beauty rest in you, a glance reveals the mood of you. I'll never let you go, I love you so. There's much that dads can sing and shout it loud, and girls forgive, and proudly know that once upon a time, it was just so. So let me go as I do you, and promise me that you will do the same as I will always promise now. And keep me close and love me more as we can wander distant shores. And call me when you need to be, I'm there. I left you once and left you then. I can't describe the most pain when. I left you to the world when you were 3. I have to realize the change once more. Again, it causes pain for dads who love the ladies in their lives. Forgive, just let me live for simply me. Remain as all my guidance and your lamplight on all seas. I raise my hands and drop that fear that crosses over Bänoo years. And once again, I hold you. As I'm destined to, so tightly, and hold my tears. Good night, sweet dreams. This one's a little darker. I suffered an illness a good few years ago that really took me down and almost took my life, which made me kind of think about all the things that I maybe hadn't done, or the things that I wished I had that I never would have a chance to. And it was an attempt to deal with mortality. I mean, I think anybody who's faced that has to walk up to death and say hello and welcome it in some way. And I did it through this poetry. That was one of the reasons why I started to write more and more. So this is called Never Be. The lines on fingers reaching out for life. The roast that sizzles in the pan. The chatter right outside the door. The child wipes off his mouth and begs for more. The honeysuckle hedgerow lanes and showers. The ginger garlic Chinatown explodes. How close the faintest perfume hides. In murmurs whispered sweetly, come inside. The tide creeps closer slowly to the toes. The child that looks at love so grand. The sweating heave of youth around. The ball is caught, the grass leaps from the ground. The honeymoon that never started, ended. The music in the waking hours has ceased. the breathless kiss no longer softly found, the loneliness in deafening loss of sound. The rush of virile waterfalls still run, the feet that carry possibilities, the silver screen that transfers light, the first embrace, the falling into night. That this the child will tread on colored paths, to taste and see and feel, to cause a stir. The monumental moments climbing higher, the gift of happiness, the dawn of fresh desire. That all of this is past to lack of time. The hair grows thin, the willingness subsides. This grace of dropping slowly frowns that all these hopes and dreams crashed fiercely down. That's 5 minutes, is it?
Oh,
I don't want to get
we'll
stuck
do
away.
Another one, yeah.
Okay, I'll do it. See if we get shorter. Oh, this is kind of fun, because this, it's not about my ex-wife.
Sure.
It's about relationships that turn, and somebody turns into an antagonist right before your eyes, and almost your foe, your enemy. And for a while I tried to kind of placate that relationship. And then I gave up on that and just started to gain my own independence out of a bad marriage. So it's entitled Starved and Lonely. I'm out of apologies now for all the shit things I said and did. I've used all 5 letters over, sometimes in just jest and others at best. Sorry. I'm out of apologies now. Lament yourself. I'm not the other pillow in a fight. I'm not the layer of tar under your feather, nor the scar on your womb. Sorry. I'm out of apologies for good, forever. And it's my day to be sorry for you and the way that you screw and the things that you do and you don't and the bullseyes you hit on your panic crosshair. Porridge and sorry and lorry, 2 letters that drive me out. Sorry. I'm out of apologies now, so I'll crawl in my cave and say nothing to nothing and manage to piss in your wind and spit in my eye to make your feelings, your take, your lean, that highway. Sorry, I have my way.
Dynamic woman. Bänoo Zan is an amazing poet. She's from Iran, and she runs one of the most. She runs a monthly poetry event in Toronto that is every race, color, creed, size, sex.
Age,
all styles of writing, and she has a lot of slam as well. So it's everything from very literary poetry right through to very performance oriented. And she's an amazing performer herself, so welcome, Bänoo Zan.
Thank you. Now, if you want, I'll go for, shall we say, or the monthly event that we run is to have the same diversity that you get on the streets under one roof. So if you're interested but not already connected, you want to be bothered with information, come to me. You probably have heard these recent tragedies that have been happening during this year's Hajj pilgrimage. You know, lots of people have lost their lives. So in Iran, when someone wants to go on Hajj pilgrimage, they go and meet with everyone in their family, relatives, friends, colleagues, even the people they have broken up with. They make their peace, they ask forgiveness, They go on that journey as if it's the last journey on their life. So I wrote this poem. I hope I have it memorized. The title is The Hajj Pilgrim. Khuda, O God, they say you're a man in Tawaf, on the day of Arafah, stoning the shaitan. They say you're a woman covering your breasts from the non-mahram, your long hair in hijab. They say you're angry, never drink or dance, never smile. But I've seen you with Muhammad in intimate embrace of religion and justice, chaste and naked. You love like a man. You give up everything for a kiss. You love like a woman. You want everything in a kiss. I heard you are converting from you to the lover you are. Wash blood off bombs and believers. Mourn the loss of innocence in the ritual of need. Shave your head, cut your nails, wrap yourself in ihram, and join the humble crowd that dies for a visit from you.
Scraps of notes. Okay. Oh, another quote. Favorite quote of mine, Meister Eckhart. He once wrote, if the only prayer you ever say is thank you, that will suffice. So I'd like to thank the gallery for hosting us. I'd like to thank Brenda for inviting us, me, and thanks for all the open stage people. That's great. And Sean, first time, wow. Okay, you might hear a touch of Africa in this. I wasn't thinking of that when I wrote it. And don't ask me what it means. Ooh-do. 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 Another time. Ooh-do. Ooh-do. Another time. Ooh-do. Ooh, do, nut, tack, ooh, do, flock, land, ooh, do, nut, tack, ooh, do, fire, hands, ooh, do, nut, tack, ooh, do, hail, storms, ooh, do, nut, tack, ooh, do, rain, stars, ooh, do, nut, tack, ooh, do, old tree, ooh, do, nut, tack, ooh, do, lily, star, ooh, do, nut, ta, who do play the, who do na ta, who do mud star, who do na ta, who do shadow hands, who do na ta, who do one heart, who do na ta, who do na ta, who do na ta, who do, who do. Do.
Well, Sean, we're
giving away his first poem. In a way, this is a first poem because it's about things I learned. You might recognize something too, probably learned. Now I know trans blue eyes. Now I know flowers come spring. Now I know impossible verbs. Now I know sky is not ground. Now I know old nursery rhymes. Now I know the names of things. Now I know mama, papa. Now I know laughing, crying. Now I know crawl through gardens. Now I know how to tie strings. Now I know bamboo sticks. Now I know boundary stones. Now I know walls of white. Now I know smoke and water. Now I know about lizard traps. Now I know solitude catch. Now I know die lying down. Now I know empty stomach. Now I know swallow flowers. Now I know a house of fog. Now I know broken stones. Now I know the place of fire. Now I know birth and blood. Now I know red evening flowers. Now I know stolen mirrors. Now I know crying, crying. Now I know how lost the sky. Now I know day is not day. Now I know backward steps. Now I know slower and slower. Now I know old wanderings. Now I know forgotten words. Now I know it moves along. Now I know earth's been away. Now I know wind and breath. Now I know whispering. Now I know the things of things. Now I know a listening wind. Now I know touch and rain. Now I know shivering trees. Now I know impassioned leaves. Now I know of the sky, now I know other suns, now I know circles of stones, now I know chalk in the rain, now I know. Oh, I know, Brenda, you like your philosophical references. Now I know the things of things, that would be the end of Cottrill, get back to the things themselves. But, somebody said my philosophy education was wasting. This is kind of cute and meta because there was a poetry series called We Got Words, and I thought that was a great title for a poetry series. So I wrote a poem, We Still Got Words. A poem about a poetry series. We still got words, wide words, wild words, words gone into the streets, words chipping through electromagnetic currents. We still got e-words. We still got an alphamnemonic maze. We're still writing through a dream. We still got verbs, verbs coming into being, accents on the expressive. We got inflections that turn and twist and point to the sky. We got letters to the sky. We still got questions, lots of questions. Questions going around in circles in an infinite spiral. Circle questions descending into silence, the silence that transcends all circles, because every question goes beyond itself. Every question is about the infinite. We still got infinite questions. Between each step, we still got mystery. We still got multiplicity, multiple meanings, multicolored rooms we wander through and through and through. Each room with its own vibration. We still got vibrations. We still got noise and blood. Blood chakras shrieking. We still got chaos and repetition, burning icons and funeral melodies. We still got fear of death. We still got the unknown, an open sky within our breath. The aura of flowers and frost. Dreams after awakening. Words are dream sounds. Drum beats. We still got beats. Sounds with inferred meanings. Beats going on, going on, going on everywhere. Out of time. We still got words. We still got the next audience. We still got tomorrow. It's an Aztec ritual, or was, of praying to flowers to destroy their enemies. I was fascinated by that because we don't think of flowers as having destructive energy. We think of them, romantically or poetically or in mourning. But we don't think of them as having destructive energy. I offer flowers. I sow flower seeds. I plant flowers. I assemble flowers. I pick flowers. I pick different flowers. I remove flowers. I seek flowers. I spread flowers. I spread flowers across the ground. I scatter flowers. I scatter flower seeds in the wind. I throw flowers. I throw flowers across the sky. I make a flower necklace, a paper of flowers, a flower shield, hand flowers. I offer painted flowers. I offer flowers painted on blue flutes. I offer flowers mixed with gray mud. I dance over yellow flowers. I trace a circle of flowers around the sun. I offer an alphabet of flowers, a labyrinth of flowers, a stone city of flowers. I bring flowers deeper into the park. I remove flowers from your voice. I remove flowers inside us. I clothe you in flowers. I cover you in flowers. I injure you with flowers. I destroy you with flowers. I destroy you with flowers, with flaming flowers, with burning colors, with poison smoke. I destroy you with flowers ground under your feet, with burial flowers in your hands, with blackened flowers scorched through stones. I destroy you with screeching tone flowers, with broken flowers, with flowers burning over the water. I destroy you with flowers bleeding out of your nostrils and your mouth. I destroy you with the flowers of eclipse, with flowers covering over the sun. I destroy you with the shadow of flowers, with flowers bent backwards receding into darkness. I destroy you with ghost flowers abandoned on an island, with flowers falling back, flowers far away, flickering and gone. I smell flowers crushed into your tears. I smell flowers rising to the rain, flowers coloring the rain, a polyphony of flowers filled with rain, filling the streets, falling from the sky. I ask flowers to bury our city. I mix millions of prayer flowers. I mix purple mystery flowers. I mix red flowers with our blood hearts. I assemble flowers to meet the horizon. I scatter flowers to bring the skies together. I spread flowers as the sun. I offer flowers from the still mountain. I offer flowers breathing the air. I offer flowers between silence. I offer flowers yet unborn. I offer flowers after you cry. I offer a single morning flower. Let's try. the stolen from a watering sky. Rainwater coffee at the end of time. Drenched in shadow from the dark eye sky. Got water spot stains on my blue black boots. Got echo outlines on the watercolor streets. And I'm walking through mirrors of rainbow spit. And I'm crashing through mirrors of water in the streets. And I'm going to step on and I'm going to step through. Got water on my shoe. It's raining on a breath, blurred, beautiful breath. And it's raining in a mouth through water and smoke. Ring with that light, our piggy steps. Squoosh through water, a ring of rivulets. Shadows and drown and let the bodies. And all the watercolors overflow the boundaries. And I'm gonna step on and I'm gonna step through. I got water on my shoe. And the walls are asleep and the perfume sky. From a fist full of mint breathing in the night. And the rain is endless and we're wet in our souls. And we're stepping with the sky and the water. Stones, and I'm gonna step on, and I'm gonna step through, and I'm gonna step on, and I'm gonna step through, and I'm gonna step on, and I'm gonna step through. Got water in my shoe. That one's rough, but I like it.
We'll take a break after you finish.
Okay, because we definitely need to talk about it.
Yeah.
That's the latest one you wrote, is it's a rough draft, so if anyone doesn't like it, you can say, well, it's not done. Out of my breath comes light. Out of my breath comes leaves of light. Comes leaves breathing the light. Comes trees that drink night from the sun. Out of my breath comes a dream filled with butterflies, a handful of air, plumes of smoke, and an unfolding cloud. Out of my breath comes infinite buds swelling and opening. Comes the smell of wet grass, of damp soil, of the taste of our skin, of our salt. Out of my breath comes water dripping through windows, dripping off our fingertips and into sacky cups. Out of my breath comes a sweet spice and tang of the first taste of samosas and passion fruit juice, Mombasa sea salt air. Out of my breath comes a thousand birds, caught, caged, and freed for a price on the sinking stones of Piazza San Marco. Out of my breath comes a stream of fish swallowing fire. Comes a shrieking behind expensive car exhaustion. Comes a shrieking out of Gaia's exhaust fume groans. Comes the aging lines of my skin becoming patterns. Comes an endless hallway that always leads to the same room. Out of my breath comes cathedrals of dust. Comes the stations of the cross abandoned for plantations. Comes plantations abandoned for fields of wild roses. Out of my breath comes the flower of your mouth. Comes our melting eyes. Comes the water droplets on our eyes. Comes our vision always wet. Out of my breath comes a smile. Comes a smile as warm as blood. Out of my breath comes a whisper. Comes a whisper that evaporates into a cloud. Out of my breath comes breath. Maybe that has something to do with this. You can go far away, across the streets, across the night, outside the lights on my street, behind my home, beyond my eyes, far away, across the fields, beyond the mountains, beyond the clouds. You can go far away. Far away. You can hide your glance in a star, in the distance, sapphire. A yellow light, rush light, dissolve breath, a distant star. A distant star. Your name can fall into shadow. Out your body, float away. Your breath can slip outside to the sky, far away. Creation smiles, side flap, side of world, inside. Birds circle a distant shore. Breathe the dawn far away. Far away. Far away.
Waleed Abdulhamid was born in Sudan, so we've got this Africa theme. He began performing at the age of 6, that's incredible, and he's known for bringing traditional rhythms into popular music, and he's played right across the top of Africa, all the countries. In the northern part of Africa, and also Stockholm, Copenhagen, Frankfurt, Oslo. He demonstrates this. He plays guitar, bass, drums, harmonica, kirin, darabuka, marimba, congas, djembe, dumbak, and tamba, and has been invited to perform in festivals and conduct workshops in Spain, France, UK, and Portugal. You're so international. I love it. He's one of the 12 resident artists at Soul Pepper Theater. And he's played with the Clayton, Motown legend, the band The Drifters, Doug Riley. And the list goes on. You can, when I post the pictures, I'll also include the info. He's a film director. Has a winning documentary, Let's Find a Way, and has been a music director, and so he just comes with much pedigree. How about that? so happy to have you. I've seen him accompany poets, mostly Norman, and I just, you know, really.
A lot of them. She knows as well.
And I just really wanted to feature him so that I could listen.
Thank
just
so
to Waleed.
Yeah, really great to be here. Beautiful space. Yeah. Thank you so much. And I get inspired by hearing those beautiful words from you guys. I used to watch people play, like, usually play extreme bass, and I have, you know, different style of evolving that bass, and I was also backup. We did a little bit of rehearsal, but I didn't know this bass like this acoustic, how nice, beautiful, small. I will start with a song called Malaika. Malaika in Swahili and also in a lot of different languages mean angels. And this song made famous by Maria Makeba and Harry Belafonte in the early, I believe, 70s. After Maria Makeba, she left South Africa. But the song written by a composer, young man from Tanzania. And the lyric says, I love you, you are my angel. I have nothing to offer you, I don't have money, but I have my love. Would you marry me, please? And you know, the fight, and he had a struggle with her to convince her family to accept him as, you know, yeah. Sometimes I feel like I am a reporter. I just want to report. You know, don't really just grab and write the lyrics. Like, I get inspired by hearing, you know, your story and your story about the hiding, about those things. And then, you know, something will come up to me, but I don't really just grab the guitar and just, oh, that's compulsory. It really comes naturally and organically, you know, I will do it. Which is, I do a lot of music for theater as well. I compose a lot of music for theater and film. And that was inspired by seeing the visual, by seeing the footage of the film. And this one called Sinsimal Gadarif. Sinsimal means sesame. Sesame is just a simple seed, but in this region in Sudan, in the mountain called Fonj, if the harvest season is successful, the whole village, like they are like, is a carnival for them. These little seeds mean so much to them, you know, that the harvest season to be successful, you know, and afterwards, like, you know, they have this sesame is healthy and they can sell it and live with it. And the people of that region, they call the Fonj, they're extremely healthy. Healthy in a way like, even the way they hear, there is a woman from France, I forgot her name actually, I have her book. She did a study about them. They hear like way more than 20 miles. They can hear, yeah. I mean, they live in the top of the mountain probably. They never been exposed to any of this stuff we are, you know, exposed to. Even in small, like you find, there's some town, they're very busy, the same as Toronto, they're building on cars and a lot of noise. But you go more, you go out, you see, like even, you know, the body type, and you know, you can tell, like, all those people, they're very healthy, you know, and the way they live and the way they eat as well. This one called Sesame, Simsimal Gabard, and it's a traditional song, but as you know, I took it out of the tradition, and also I capped the rhythm of it and I recompose it in a different way for a new generation, just to keep that tradition alive. They can, you know, at least hear some harmony, something relate, you know, they can listen to it, which is, I think I'm a little successful, you know. You can find it if you write with it, I mean, Simsim, which is S-I-M-S-I-M, you know, usually I play with the bass. All this stuff, like I play with the bass as chord, and yeah.
Baby, baby. Africa.
one now. I'm from Sudan, you know, my region, but Nubian, my background. And as a lot of indigenous people talk, you know, sometimes other culture come and you lose your language, you lose a big part of your tradition, your religion, and the whole thing. And most of people in my age that live in town, like, I don't speak, at first I don't speak Nubian, but my grandma and most of my elders, they will speak Nubian. And an extremely unique culture, supposed to be one of the oldest civilizations in the planet. You know, those are the people that built the pyramids, and a lot of people, you know, they arrived, you know, this pyramid built by European. You know, Egypt and Sudan, if you Google, like, you'll see the those pyramids pretty much built by Africa. You know, most of those sessions they were, you know, they would break their noise out just to hide a lot of things. And this song called Sambra is adapted a little bit back to the Rigia. The Rigia, it's a language come out of Arabic language. And there's a little bit of Nubian, but the origin of the song, it's Nubian.
Alexandra. Alexandra featured fairly recently at Lizzie Violet's Cabaret Noir, and I got to hear really a whole chunk of your work, and it's so interesting. My goodness, you've known a lot of people. No, such an interesting life. It's
That's
amazing.
My life,
right? but her poems are also quite, they could also be lyrics to songs.
Yeah.
So there's a simplicity as well as these, this just incredible life you've lived. But there's also like, and I've heard her sing, I heard her on karaoke. You really should put, even if it's not your own tune, you really, because your poetry is already music. It's there, and the imagery, but you said you don't hear music. Whatever. That's my thing.
Thank you. Thank you.
Maybe at some point you will.
Yes, maybe at some point. Who knows?
Miracles do happen. Prepare some pieces, yeah.
So I'd like to pop back into the room because you inspired me to do this one when you were doing your Water in My Shoe poem, which I totally adore.
Oh,
so
much.
So, because I usually lug around this big black book of poetry, and of course I left it at home, so I was reduced to, oh my goodness, what can I remember? And when you were doing that poem, I remember this one. So the title to this one is, actually, it's not something you can speak because it's $6 signs or whatever. So I guess it could be money, 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 money. And it goes like this. Who the hell needs money anyway? As soon as you've got it, you throw it away. You got no dollars, you got no tomorrows. Don't do it if it doesn't pay. But I'm gonna find another way. I've done it before and I'll do it again. And I just won't let them break my chain of thought. And we fought on the beaches, we fought on the hills. It's weird how some people get their thrills. So I won't let you push me back into your mold. I'll keep on doing what I'm not told. It's not my problem if you feel old as hell. This one is called Welcome to the Human Race. You freaked me out in the restaurant with your food sliding off your face. And the part of your body you spoke of with the shock of your lack of grace. And we've all been fooled by sensation as a bitter, frustrating rule. And we've all let our love grow cold at night. My love, we have all been fools. I'm with a very short one. It's a poemette, I suppose. I've read a lot of short poems. This is called Goodbye, Marilyn, and it's about the Marilyn. They found her with a telephone in her hand. Who was she calling? The promised land? The girl, they said, who had it all, except good luck with her final call.
Jeff, is you do humor, and you're like, I can't explain you, let's put it that way. Like, you are all of who you are, but he is. You're going to Paris soon. Are you going to do some open mic over there?
Doing two gigs actually.
Oh, congratulations! Will you be seeing Arlene at all?
We're just missing Arlene, who's there like a few days before I am.
So you've got two gigs.
Yeah.
Fantastic.
Yep.
Yeah. Do you have a book coming out?
I have a CD.
Oh, great!
It's only $5, and it will make you happy.
I'm about to ask Abdul. Has he got CDs? Anyway, I can ask.
Too late now.
It is too late.
Not too late for my.
Okay, so welcome our new sort of nearly Parisian.
Ma première Berlin. So for centuries, there's been a tradition of writing poems to or about the moon. You know, it's big with the romantic poets and even Shakespeare and whatnot. So I thought I would join this tradition. So here is an ode to the moon. Fuck you, moon! Seriously, go bugger yourself, crater face. You think you're so cool up there with all your moon rocks? Dick. Oh, look at me, I'm the moon. I make people turn into werewolves. I make people go crazy when I turn full. I use my gravitational pull to cause tidal waves. Frank Sinatra sang songs about me. Michael Jackson did a dance named after me. I run circles around your crappy little planet, literally. I'm the moon, baby, and you ain't never setting foot on me, sucker. Yeah? Well, go suck on a sucking piece of something, sucko. Stupid moon. How many astronauts have visited you lately? Huh? How many? Pockmarked bastard. Been a while, hasn't it? As in a 42-year while. Why don't the astronauts like you anymore, Moon? What did you do to creep them out? Did you say something to offend them? Did they catch you doing it with their significant others? Why doesn't NASA ever call you anymore, Moon? Maybe it's because you're, I don't know, a big jerk? You're not really made of cheese, but you are cheesy. Remember when Georges Méliès made that movie in which that spaceship hit you in the eye? Well, he should have used a bigger spaceship, one that would have wiped out your whole dumb, stupid face. Or he could have sent up a nuclear bomb and blown you into a million billion moon bits. Except they didn't have nuclear energy back in 1902. Okay, scratch that one. Hey, Moon! You know the difference between you and your mom? There's only one man on the moon. Stop peeking in my window every night, you pervert. Somebody ought to moon you, Moon, you shiny pie-faced wanker. You think you're immortal, but you're just a phase. Percy Shelley once wrote about you. Art thou pale for weariness of climbing heaven and gazing on the earth? Wandering companionless among the stars that have a different birth? Yeah, hear that, Moon? Companionless. Because who'd be your companion, you lunar loser? It's only a paper moon. See, Moon? You're just paper. Well, scissors cuts your paper. And I've got scissors. Hard, quality metal scissors. Made out of the rock of the earth, and, wait, okay, I know they say paper covers rock, but that's bullshit. Rock is strong and crushes paper, too. Yeah? Stupid moon. You know that Jupiter moon, Io? I hear Io's got more than 400 working volcanoes. Where are your volcanoes, Moon? I hear you used to have some pretty good ones back in the day, but now you've got an old moon, and your volcanoes have dried up into dark maria, and there ain't no giant cosmic Viagra out there to bring them back. No, sir. You're a jerk, Moon. A complete knee-biter. I'm going to send you to the moon, Moon. You sun-reflecting, tide-causing, total-eclipsing, poet-inspiring, crater-hoarding, river-widening, poo-drumming, flying bicycle backdrop, scenery-supplying, monolith-hiding, son-of-a-fucking-fuck-faced, fuck-headed fucker. Think about that next time you beat me at peanut. Woe to the moon. Yeah. Okay, once in a while I write a poem just to piss off the slam community. And, this one, if anyone here has ever wanted to hear me do bad gangster rap, well, here you go, you're welcome.
Not enough of that around.
Right. Yo, I'm a badass, dangerous mofo. If you say the wrong thing, you'll be feeling my sting. I'll mess you up good. Don't deny that I would. I can do it without even leaving my hood. Sure, I'm only 5'1" and 18 years young and not too well hung, but I can still destroy you, chum. I'm no gangster or cop or even a dope verse dropper. Don't need weapons or fists or kung fu technique. What use are these for a card-carrying internet geek? All I need is a high-speed web connection, a laptop, a cause, and no sense of self-reflection. Cause I'm an online public shamer. I'm a privileged class blamer. I fight injustice, not with action, but with Twitter hashtags and self-righteous satisfaction. There was a neighborhood massage therapist who got me very, 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 very pissed when he posted on Facebook that college political correctness was like a witch hunt. Well, I took offense to that. I deemed it misogynistic, because if you take a look through history statistics, you'll find that no male was ever killed in a witch hunt. Except John Proctor, and Giles Corey, and George Burroughs, George Jacobs, John Willard, Samuel Wardwell, Urbain Grandier, Bertrand Guillotot, Louis Deveraz, Johannes Junius, John Ranfeldson, and in fiction, Matthew Maul. But to hell with research and facts! It was time to grind my activist axe. I put out the world word this guy hated all females through long Facebook posts and prioritized emails. I attributed sexist, hateful words of all kinds, even hinted his massage technique, crossed a few lines. It spread far and wide from the mountains to the east side, and then came the fallout from the call out. His massage therapy business started dying like that of a dentist who shot that lion. It threw his whole family into poverty and disgrace, with nowhere in decent society to show his face. And then he killed himself. But what can you do? Not much. Turned out he suffered from, like, depression or some such. How was I to know? And who was I to care? When you're hopped up on outrage, honey, all is fair. Cause I'm an online public shamer. I'm a microaggression tamer. That's how I think society seems should be mended. Let's get offended, just for the sake of getting offended. I had an ex-girlfriend by the name of Justine, and on baseball trivia she was mighty keen. There was one time she tweeted, just for some kicks, my favorite 1980s Toronto Blue Jays are Kelly Grouper and Rance Mullenix. Did you catch that? Favorite 80s Blue Jays are Kelly Grouper and Rance Mullenix? Blue Jays are Kelly Grouper? Are Kelly? Man, I was disgusted. I declared her ass busted. I told all the followers of my Twitter dispersions that Justine condoned all of R. Kelly's crimes and perversions. Sure, that wasn't what she meant, but to hell with truth and reason. I declared mob justice season. It was time to get mean. I launched the hashtag #CancelJustine. It spread around the world more quickly than Bring Back Our Girls, and then came the fallout from the call out. First, every friend called the relationship to an end. Then came her family's turn to disown her. Even her fiancé could no longer get a boner. And then she was an involuntary loner. And then her job fired her, and nobody hired her. Not long after that, she got kicked out of her flat. Had to move to a basement rife with roaches and rats. And then she killed herself. Fuck, what can I say? She should have kept quiet if she wanted to live another day. Because I'm an online public shamer. I'll divorce you from peace of mind like Kramer versus Kramer. I'm a social justice warrior. I fight hate by spreading more hate. I fight lies by spreading different lies. And the only thing that threatens my mean-spirited glee is when I wonder, wait, what if they start coming after me? Thank you. Online.